We are all celebrating together. So the 10 years we are celebrating that started on Friday is not just for me, but it's for all of us. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to know that you have entered another dimension in your journey of life. And God will begin to see you through. There are things that you couldn't figure out before, but God is going to make it to happen.
Amen.
I'm not going to give us like an anecdote or a summary of the ministry God's time assembly. We started in May, like I said, in 2011. And we started in Langley Drive, behind the courthouse in Gwinnett County there. And it's been a great journey. The day we started, it was me, my wife, and my daughter, Angie. Three of us were in church that day. Amen. And God came down mightily. It was powerful. And from here, everything began. We continued until God moved up from Langley Drive to Snellville, where we had our own property. But it was a bogus deal. We were there about 1 year, getting to 2 years, and the house was taken by the bank. So we didn't have a church anymore. But the church is not a building, the church is us. So wherever we were was the church. So we began to move from hotel to back. Some of us met us in this journey. Mr. Leroy has been with us from Lawrenceville, Langley Drive up till now. And Sister Ngozi also from Langley Drive up till now. Amen. So this thing I'm saying is not like I'm saying something that they didn't experience. Sometimes they will call me, when are we having service today? Because we are not sure where the service will be. We're having service everywhere. At the end, we started having service in our house. We did it in our house for almost a year or two. Because we had a contract with the hotel, but every time we show up, then we have an event in that place. And we have a contract signed. And they will tell us to talk to the management. And before you finish making that phone call, the Spirit of God in you is gone. So I just told them, enough of this, let's go home. So in the course of this multiple moving, a lot of people left us, but they didn't see what I saw. The Bible said, because of what Moses saw, an invisible God, that even the prince of Egypt did not entice him. To be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter did not move him. He abandoned Egypt and the wealth of the Egyptians and went away and stayed alone in the wilderness for 40 years, walking with cattle and goats and sheep, because he saw an invisible God. If I was not really called, probably there will be no God's time assembly today. But we'll continue to preach in season and out of season. God opened us up into the international ministry, and by then I will be in Africa sometime for 2 months, 3 months. My wife was the one being the father, the mother in the house, and also the pastor. And every Sunday I have to call and say, did you do service today? Yes, we did service here. She was moving with the kids, moving with the equipment. Do you know what it means to carry equipment in the car? And you have to set it up?
Yep.
And she did all that. If she didn't know what she saw in me, or if she did not see the vision that I saw, the marriage would have been destroyed because of that. Because it's very, very uncomfortable. But she will do it. I will beg her and say, please, can you do service today? And she said, I will do it. And I'll call back to see how the service went. And we continue to do all that. Amen.
Amen.
So when you see this 10 years journey, it was not all rosy. But God keeps showing us glimpses of light. God didn't allow us to fall by the wayside. We did not end up in the corners of the road. We continued in what we saw. And God began to see us through. That 4 years gave us a voice in the world. When we had a big church, people didn't know me. When we lost our church, I was one of the most sought out preachers in Africa. I traveled from coast to coast to coast, in Europe, everywhere, because we were visible and we had the world. At the time I said, God, is it all I will do? Let's go back home. I need to have a place. God never answered me that prayer. I prayed for a while, but until we got here, I knew that God has given us this place. So since then, I began to cancel appointments. A lot of people are asking me, what is wrong with you? They'll write a program and I'll tell them, I'm because I have a family. You all are my family. I would have been out there preaching and making a lot of money, because I'm already known. Just to consult me as a bishop, it comes with a lot of fees. But I abandoned everything. Conventions, convocations, ordinations, they will say, yeah, try to get his faith, everything. I said, no, we cannot come now. Because when Jesus began his ministry, the first thing you do is to be like the sheep as a pastor. And many of you are going to be in leadership. You don't come from the top. You come from the bottom up. You be like the sheep. You begin to smell like the sheep. You begin to eat with the sheep, talk with the sheep. Many of you have been to my house, eat and talk. We are family. Until God grow your sheep that is so big that you cannot be with all of them at a go, you begin to be in front of the sheep. The sheep will now begin to follow you. Where Jesus is today, he doesn't have to be in front of the sheep or be with the sheep. He has to be above the sheep. And many people will never reach there. Whereby the sheep doesn't have to see you. Say, my sheep shall hear my voice and they shall follow. Because if you have not been long with the sheep, they will not know your voice. You have to be so embedded with the sheep that the sheep knows the voice of the master. Jesus was so confident in himself that he said, the voice of strangers they will not follow. He said, my sheep hears my voice and what? Follow me. The voice of stranger they will not. You can't say that if your sheep does not know your voice. So God began to teach me to stay with the sheep and be with the sheep. Because going out there to empower ministries and people will be blessed. And some of these people, I will never meet them again. Some of them I might. People write me online all the time, start to tell me where they met me and what God did in their life through me. But they are not my sheep. And that's another thing I want to tell you, the three levels of leadership. When people see you as a leader, they begin to follow you. That does not mean that those people are your people. Some people make that mistake. They just see some leadership quality in you. They follow you. All these people, I see them as followers. They are not my sheep. But when the people begin to like you as a leader, they will begin to obey you. That is when you have gone beyond them seeing you and following you. Now they can now relate to what you are saying. They obey you. When you say something, they will do it. Even if they don't meet with you forever. You say, I have a book out there, please can you go buy? People will just go and buy the book. They don't even have any relationship with you. You say, we have a project we are doing. They send you a gift. That is when they obey you. But the highest level of leadership is when people love you as their leader. They will honor you. And when I talk about honor is not what you say to somebody, I honor you. Honor comes with reverence. It comes with gift. The Bible says, honor the Lord with your God with your substance. You don't honor God with say, God, I honor you today. No. You say, it is honor to say that. Anytime you are going to honor anybody, make sure you give them something. You don't send somebody text say, Bishop, you know I honor you. No. That's the wrong way to appreciate somebody. So that is the highest level of leadership. Some people might not get there. But get to the place where people will obey you. Where you can have influence over their life. You can direct them positively to become better. So what am I saying? I'm saying all this to say is that it's been a journey. Maybe can you come forward, please? I just want to thank my wife for believing and standing with me. You know, sometimes you might think, I've seen a lot of pastors that their marriage break, not because of infidelity, not because the man is not being a man, but because the wife is not up to the responsibility. People call me 12 midnight. I have to take the calls. 2 a.m. Sometimes I'm just in a family mood and I have a call. I'll say, excuse me, I have to. Because when you are a minister, when duty calls, you must answer. You work 24 hours. And the person on the other side might not know that I have to explain myself many, many times to my wife. Say, don't worry. This call is important. You have to take it. Amen. And sometimes when I finish taking the call, I have to come back and say, don't worry. It has to do with the ministry. But over time,
time now, she now understands. She doesn't have to ask me. Was my phone ringing? Say, your phone is ringing, please. Somebody's calling. Amen. It takes a lot of patience to get here. I really appreciate you. I thank you for all that you have been doing. Amen. Amen. So I appreciate every one of you that are here today. This journey, you made it happen. Mr. Leroy, I remember in those days, we have to move around, and he was always moving with me. It's not easy, because whatever God has revealed to me, they are not there. If I communicate to you, say this is what God is saying, some people will not want to do it. But he moved, like, back to back. Sometimes we show up, we have to change the venue. In the same day, we say, okay, wait, the service is not holding here today, let's go to some other place. But we didn't come from the highway. We were trained in this thing. So it doesn't matter if there is no roof, there is no microphone, we can still preach. Because it is a necessity in our life. We have been sold to the gospel. We are not doing this because we want to receive anything, but this is a calling. And anytime you are doing what you are called to do, you find peace in yourself. Regardless of whatever happens, there is peace in me. Some people are called for real, but when they begin to do it and they see the challenges that come with that, they deviate from their calling. Some people sell their calling. I remember in those days when people were calling me for deliverance, some people would call and say, how much is it to consult you? I said, we don't do consultation. They say, you are different. And some of those would have asked you, how much is it to consult you? They will come and you pray for them, they will leave without giving an offering. So, sometimes I look at the pastors that put price tag on everything. I don't want to blame them because they have to pay their bills. But that's not what God told me. Salvation is free. Free are you giving. And free you shall receive. The person that did not come back to thank the Lord, it's not me now, it's the person. The Bible says Jesus healed 10 lepers. 10. And as they left, everybody remembered their wife, their children, their grandmother, their father, their business, and they went about their thing. One said, no, I will go back to that man. And when he came, he says, I am among the people you healed. Jesus said, were you not 10 that I just healed? Well, what about the 9? The 9 have gone away for their businesses. And the Bible says Jesus told the man that you have been made what? Whole. So before he was healed, but now his life is complete. Because he came back to thank God. So some people might think they have stolen blessings from God. The devil is waiting for you on the other side. The devil has not retired. In fact, he's working 24 hours. Thank you, Jesus. So that is kind of the general summary of where we are. And I know that since we have entered the double digits in our number 10 to this year, we are going higher from here.
Amen.
Every one of you, when I say go higher, is this name is not the church. The registration is not the church. The church is you and me. The Bible says, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst. So when we say the church is moving forward, it's you that is moving forward.
Amen.
God said, tell the children of Israel, it is time for them to go forward.
Yes.
From today, forward ever. Amen. Backward never in your life. In the name of Jesus,
amen.
You shall begin to become everything that God has put in you.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Let's just go straight to the word. The Bible says the entrance of the word giveth light and understanding to the simple. Lord, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Let the word that we are hearing and speaking now not be an enticing word of a man.
Yes.
But let it be the word of God that will bring glory to thy holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
So the word for us is time to go forward. This is day 3. For those of you that were not here, I'm just going to read our text again. Exodus chapter 14. When the children of Israel were moving on their journey to their destination, Exodus 14, and they came to a place that was like nothing is going to happen anymore. And many of them began to be afraid. The Bible says in let's start from verse 10 of Exodus 14. It says, and when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid. And the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Then they said to Moses, because there was no graves in Egypt, have you taken away us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you so dealt with us to bring us up out of Egypt? Verse 12. Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness. I want you to say, God forbid. You were never created to die a servant. You see, sometimes slave is not in the thing that you are, it is in the mind. These people, God have done everything after 430 years, brought them out, and they're still saying, it is better for us to continue to serve and die in Egypt. And when they began to chastise Moses, verse 13, and Moses said to the people, he began to preach to them, do not be afraid, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, you shall see again no more forever. Amen. I want you to say, all my Egyptians shall be no more.
All my Egyptians shall be no more.
Forever.
Forever.
So Moses began to motivate them, because their spirit went down. I don't blame them. They are seeing with their eyes. Moses is seeing in the spirit. So what they saw was the Egyptians behind them. In front of them was the Red Sea. By their sides were the mountain. There was nowhere to go. They have been boxed in. So now Moses said, no. These people you are seeing, forget about them. This is the last time you will see them. I don't know what challenges that have been in your life. This is the last time you will hear of it. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Moses motivated them. But look at Moses himself. He said, for Egyptians whom you have seen today, you shall see no more forever. Verse 14. The Lord will what? Fight for you, and you shall hold their peace. After he has preached that great message, the morale and the mind of the people came back. They were happy. They are ready to even die there. Moses went now to God in verse 15. That is where our text is coming from. Moses had motivated the people. He went back to God to hear from God. And the Bible says, and the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? This is the man that just preached and said, look, we are going to take over everything. We are moving forward. You know, these Egyptians, they are nobodies. We are going to take over. We are going to kill them. And people are happy, waiting for him to do something. He went back to the closet and began to cry. That is the heart of a father. He don't want to show emotion in front of the people. He went behind and started to cry. God said, why are you crying? You just preached a great message. You just told them what will happen. Why are you crying? God didn't speak to Moses. God told him to go back and tell them what he said. The Bible said in verse 15, and the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward, but lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the seas and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea, and I will deal with the heathen. And I indeed will harden the heart of Pharaoh and the Egyptians, that they shall follow them. So I will gain on over Pharaoh and over all the armies, his chariots and his horses and his men. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So now, God said, go back. You just told them what will happen and you are coming to cry. You don't have to cry to me. Go and tell them to move forward. Now, the people you are telling to move forward, there is water in front of them. This is not small water. It's not like a creek or some kind of stream that you run over. This is a sea. And they are looking at what about it? Moses said, move forward, and people are calling. But the water will not part until they move forward. Many things you are afraid of is afraid of you. The moment you begin to come close to your enemy, they will begin to retreat. Some of us are so afraid of the things that are in front of us. The only way you can overcome a bully is to bully them back. The day you reject your condition, reject the situation in your life and say, I'm moving forward, the devil cannot even stop you. Because by then your spirit, your soul, and your body is in tandem. You have agreed in yourself. The Bible says, if two shall agree, touching anything, it shall be established. What God did was to continue in what Moses said. Moses have said it all, that these people will be drowned today. And God has to concur with him and say, tell them to move forward. And as they stretch forth their feet, Moses stretched his rod in the sea. And the Bible says, God said, divide it. And he divided it, and the sea parted. And the ground became an express road. You know, when you go on a place that water has been for a while, there's going to be some mud and stones. You know, it's not going to be level. But it happened in a minute that as the water was divided, the whole land was dried up. And the stones and everything leveled itself. That the children of Israel have to walk on dry ground. And that was where God baptized all of them. That was the baptism. He baptized the children of Israel before they crossed over. The waters were beside them. And they walked on dry ground. And they crossed over. By the time they came out, the last man came out, and the Egyptians entered. They have seen an express road that they did not build. They entered. They got halfway. God just brought the water back, and everybody died. That is how your problem is over today. Yeah. Your challenges are over. Yeah. In the name of Jesus Christ. Yeah. You don't have to cry anymore. Yeah. I want us to go to 1 Samuel. Let's see another man of God that, you know, sometimes as a leader, leaders cry. You know, I just gave you a 10 years anecdote of our ministry. There were times of weeping, sorrow, pain. Moses cried. Look at another leader here, 1 Samuel chapter 13. This man of God was a man that in his life he fought 60 battles and won all of them. But we can see that he was a man. David cried like a baby here. In 1 Samuel chapter 13, the Bible says, now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag. So David went to war with the Amalekites. He defeated the Amalekites. Now he was coming home to Ziklag where his wives and his people were. And the Bible said the Amalekite has invaded the south and Ziklag and attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire. And taking captive the women and those who were there, from small to great, they did not kill anybody but carried them away and went their ways. Verse 3. So David and his men came to the city and they was burnt with fire. Bless you. Hallelujah. The Bible says, and they were burnt with fire. And their wives and their sons and their daughters had been taken captives. Verse 4. Then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David and David's two wives, Ahinom and Jezreelites, and Abigail, the widow of Nabal, the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because their souls, the soul of all the people, were grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. I want you to know that when you have challenges in front of you, it is okay to cry. I'm not going to be here and tell you that if you cry, oh, you're a weak person. No. If you feel like crying, cry. But after you cry, don't stay in crying. The Bible says everybody was crying. David also cried because he has his two wives and the wife of Nabal that he took, and their sons and their daughters were taken. David has 600 men, and everybody have a wife and children. So you know these people swept the whole camp and burnt it down. So everything he has worked for all his life has been destroyed in one day, and now he doesn't know the condition and the situation of his family. And everybody began to cry. David also was crying. But something touched me here. The Bible said the people looked at him and said, if we did not follow David, this thing could have happened to us. The people thought of stoning him. These are the people that went out with him. They said, this leader is a bad leader. We have to kill him. That was when David, the Bible said, David encouraged himself and went back to God. Look at verse 8. Go with this, God. Thank you, Jesus. So David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue after these two? Shall I overtake them? Now he's not even including his men. He could have said, shall we pursue? Because his men has rejected him. And sometimes you need to stand alone to be able to see God. He had 600 men, but everybody was crying for their own children and their families and their houses. So they rejected the leader. David retreated and went back to God and began to inquire, began to question God. He said, shall I pursue after this truth? Will I overtake them? And look at what God said. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And he answered him, say, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them, and without a fail, recover all. I want you to say, I will recover all.
I
don't care what has happened in your life. You are here to recover everything.
Amen.
Not in the same coin. If you have lost a dime, you are not getting a dime. You are getting more than a dime.
Amen.
It must be restituted. There must be sevenfold, tenfold, 50-fold, 30-fold. You are recovering all.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
David did not just recover his wife and his properties. He recovered. After this battle, he became the richest man in Israel. That was the battle of his life. This was the last battle in David's life. But before the last battle, he was crying. I don't know what has kept you crying. You have been crying all day, all week, all months. The pandemic touched everybody. I don't know who ever on this earth that did not feel the pain of the pandemic. Some people got richer, but they lost something. Everyone has lost something in this pandemic. Some lost family members. Some lost their job. Some grandparents have not seen their grandkids for over 2 years because they are sick. And all kinds of things have happened. But I'm telling you that it's time for recovery.
Amen.
The Bible says, God said, pursue. I don't care what has been challenging you. It is time for you to pursue, for you to overtake, and without a fail, recover everything.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And David pursued. When God said that, there was no army to fight with. David was talking about himself. So when he came back and said, we are going to war, 400 men followed. The other 200 said, we are tired, we are not going anywhere. This is a leader that before David would not say, do you know that there was a time David was thirsty of water, just water? He said, I'm thirsty. His men went into the camp of the Philistines and killed people to bring water. And when they brought the water, David said, where did you get it? He said, we got it in the camp of the Philistines. David said, no, I cannot drink this water. This is a blood water. He poured it away. He said, God, how can, just because I felt that I'm thirsty, these young men have to put their life in danger to get water for me. But these are the same men now that have rejected their leader because there was a challenge in his life. I don't know who has rejected you. I don't know who has abandoned you. I don't know who have left you. But if people leave you, don't leave yourself.
Amen.
And let me tell you, sir, you are no longer where the devil left you. The devil might have kept you in a place thinking that he's coming back to see you there. Your address have changed.
Amen.
Your dressing have changed.
Amen.
Your words have changed.
Amen.
Even your physical structure has changed. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So then he said, who is going with me? 400 say we are going. 200 say we are not going. And they left. As they began to pursue, we don't have time to read all these things. The Bible said they came and saw an Egyptian man almost dying. And they picked him up and brought the guy to David. And David looked at him and said, feed him. This guy was an enemy. You know, sometimes the people that will help you, they will not look like the people that will help you. You need to feed them for at least 1 year before the things that is in them will come out. Success comes like work. Dressed up with overall, ready to go to work. And many of us will see success and say, no, that's not for me. I don't want to work. But inside that work is where your blessing is. David saw a dying man. He has lost his family. But he said, feed him. And they gave him bread and water. They began to feed him. The Bible says life came back into the man. And they asked him, "What servant are you?" He said, "I'm one of the servants of the Amalekites." But do you know that the guy was their GPS? This guy has all the places they have invaded. He has where they are going. He has every map. But because he was so sick, and they dropped him to die. And he was there for 3 days before David found him. So for 3 days he was wounded and he had no food. And David fed this guy until life came back to him. And David said, "Tell me." The guy said, "Before I speak to you, you have to make an agreement with me that you will not kill me." And David said, "Yes, that is done." He said, "But you will not hand me over to my master." David said, "That is also done." The guy brought out everywhere they have been and told him every loot they have looted. The cars, the house, the money, the everything. And he told David where they would be. And they carried him. When they came here, lo and behold, the Amalekites were dancing. How foolish are these people? They were dancing and celebrating their loot. They had built camps. They did not see it coming. The Bible says David killed and killed and killed and killed and killed. They wiped them out. The loot and the goods that they carried that day. David had never seen that level of wealth. Because God allowed the Amalekites to begin to raid every city, to loot every town, every community, every country. And the Ziklag was the last place. So all the looting they have carried, the gold and the silver, the precious stones, every artifice, everything they have gathered, David collected the spoils. The Bible said the spoil was so much that David became the richest man in the whole world. He gave to his servants. And the people were saying, "We will not give to the other 200 men that did not come with us." And David said, "No, I'm going to send the president." And he told them, "So we are sharing with them. Not only are we sharing with the 200 men, we are going to share with all the elders of Israel and all my friends." The wealth was so much that when they came back, they shared wealth, and there was so much wealth. David said, "I want to build a house for God." Because the resources cannot be matched with anything. But I want you to know that before that level of blessing, the man was crying. Sometimes when you come to the point of breakthrough, the devil will corner you and wallet you to one side and tell you that it's not possible anymore. You go back. A lot of people have come to their brink of succeeding and they did not make it. I heard a story of a young man during the time of the gold rush in America. And everybody was going west looking for gold. He went and took all the family's investment and sold it here and run off to the west and bought a big piece of land. And they began to dig and look for gold. And they did it for 12 years. They couldn't find gold. And he sold it. The next people that came, it was 1 foot to gold before he sold it. The next company that bought it, it took them 1 foot to get gold, and they were bringing out gold and they were selling gold. But he worked labor for 12 years. And when he decided to say, "I'm not paying workers anymore, we are not digging any, let's shut this thing down and sell it," they were just 1 foot to gold. He didn't know. If it was now, technologies, they will see everywhere there's gold. There's things that you can use and just scan the ground and see. In those days, there was nothing like that. He wrote a book about it, he became a bestseller. See, whatever you have desired and you have invested, don't quit on it. He sold the whole of their family investment, invested in the land, and left it for somebody to come and reap. You will never labor and somebody reap. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, every of your labor will bring to you the desired harvest. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Rabada Shikataba, we are going to pray now. I want you to stand on your feet. Today we are going to make some declaration and decrees. If it's possible, if you cannot stand, you sit down. It's okay. Oh, Rabaga Shikata Baba. Thank you, Jesus. What we discovered from David and Moses is the two stories look alike. Moses was crying to God. God said, "Why are you crying? Go back and tell them to move forward." Now David was crying after he cried, but what got him to go to God was when they said they're going to kill him. The Bible said his men said they are going to kill David. And David retreated and went to God and said, "Should I pursue after this truth? Will I overtake?" And the Bible said, God said, "Yes, pursue. For thou shalt surely overtake them. And without a fail, you will recover everything." I don't know what you have lost. I have lost a lot. But I'm not dwelling in my loss. Yesterday we talked about you having a vision. Never you remember your past. Your job is to continue to move forward. As you continue to move forward, the things that are for you will always come. Everything you are looking for is in your forward. You don't have anything behind you because you have left that place. It's time to go forward. So what are the things that you see? The first thing to recover is you have to have a sight. David discovered that he lost something. That's why he recovered it. Many times we lose things, we don't even know what we have lost. That means when you even get it back, you will know. If you don't know where you are going in life, when you get there, you will not know. There must be a strategy, one, planning. You must know this is what is my mark. This is where what I'm pursuing. If it's a contract, it's a job, I'm pursuing a relationship, I'm pursuing age. Some people are just praying for God to give them more life. Say, if I can get to the next 10 years, you must have a target. I'll be grateful. You say, God, this is it. I don't know what it is to you, but I want you to pray. The Spirit of God is here. Let God begin to reveal to you. Everybody that you, there is a God in you. The Bible says, he that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. There is a God that is in every man. God is not up there in heaven. Heaven is a place that is thrown. If God does not live in heaven, I want you to know that today. He does not live there. God is not a static God. God is all over. Everywhere you go, you see him. You see him on earth. The Bible says the earth is the footstool of God. And the Bible says his seat, the heaven is his throne. And where is the head of God? If you get there, you see his throne. That is where he sits down. The earth is his footstool. He is all over the place. I want you to talk to that God. Say, touch me today. Visit me. Show me something. Open my eyes, my ears. Make me to understand. There are things that you don't know, different dimensions of things, questions you have been asking about yourself. It is time for you to get answers. Whatever question that you have asked, where am I going in life? God, answer me today. Speak to God. Tell him to talk to you in the language that you can understand. Many of you that speak other languages, God will speak to you in your language. God can speak every language. He is the God that created the heaven and earth. He has every power in his hand. He knows all things. Speak to him today. Touch me, Father. Hallelujah. Rekata raba sikata baba. Masoko to rekata na mashikata baba. We give you all glory and adoration. We exalt you, magnify you. We give you all exaltation. Have your way in the name of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Based on what you have seen now, and if you have not seen it, continue to pray this prayer when you get home. But if you have seen something, tell God to help you to get it. The Holy Ghost is our helper. Jesus said, I'm going to send you a helper that will abide with you forever. You cannot push him away. You cannot throw him out. You cannot sack him. He's your helper, but he's in charge. He's the one that will help you, but he's the one that controls your life. Tell the Holy Spirit. The Bible said that the Spirit, if the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in us, that same Spirit shall quicken our mortal bodies. Romans chapter 8 verse 14, they that are led by the Spirit, they are called the sons of God. Say, God, lead me now. Based on what I have seen, help me to get it. You don't have to have the strength. The strength is God's strength. The Bible says, the Lord is what? My strength. He is your power. He is your strength in weakness. In that area of your life that you are weak, God, that is God's side. That means you are strong everywhere. Say, God, help me to get it. Help me to receive it. Help me to get it now. By the authority and the power. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for we know that you have done it now. Rabobo shakata baba. Rekata raba shikata baba. Mansekete reba rika raba sikotobo. Libaga shakata baba. Rakoto robo sikata baba. Mazikata raba riko robo. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
It is done.
Amen.
It is done. It is done. It is done. Now we are going to speak back to the devil because he's here watching. He always crash parties that you don't invite him. We will be there. The Bible says the sons of God gathered in Job chapter 1, and here comes the devil. God said, what are you doing? He said, through and through. So I don't care whether the devil have heard what you say, whether he is here to preview your life. He cannot hinder you anymore.
Amen.
For the devil that you saw yesterday, you shall see the devil.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ. Every power we speak over this land of Lindborg, where we are standing to make this decree, let this land be a witness. Let the heaven and the sky over us be a witness that today you are free. You are free from everybody. You are free from sin. You are free from chains. You are free from ancestral powers, familiar spirits. You are free from spiritual husbands and wives. You are free in the name of Jesus. We decree and declare in this land and on this place today, the devil has no power over your life. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, la, 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 la. There is power in the name of Jesus. The oil of God is here. It's passion. I see a lot of you. After today, you have to be careful the way you talk. Because things you say will just start to happen.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus. Many people are receiving the oil of prophetic utterance. God is opening ears. Some of you begin to hear audible voices. Begin to see things. Because we have entered into the next dimension. This is the year of the Lord. This is the time of the power of God. It is moving everywhere. God is distributing gifts here. Dimensions are being released.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. You just have to speak the right words. So that you don't speak things that will entrench you. The Bible says a man is snared by the words of his mouth. It's not the time to say, I cannot do it anymore. The devil will hold on that word and say, you can never do it. You say, I can. The Bible says, let the weak say, I am strong. The poor say, I am rich. You keep saying, I can do it. I am healed. If you are sick in the body, say, I am healed. And every time the devil reminds me, oh, you have pain, I try to say, I am healed. Whenever the devil wants to show you that, you say, I am healed. That is God. Speak that way. And you see the devil flee from your life. The Bible says, resist him, and he shall flee from you. You resist him by the words of your mouth. When the devil told Jesus, you are hungry, Jesus knew he was hungry. Who is the devil to remind him that he was hungry? He told him, say, man does not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from God. And he looked at him again and showed him the wealth of the world. He said, bow to me and I will give you everything. Get thee behind me, Satan. He said, fall down and God will send his angels, they will guide you, which is true. It is written in Psalm 91. But the devil cannot command God. He said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. You must be able to understand, even if your mind is, because the devil is a spirit, he telepathically programmed these things in your mind. The Bible says in the book of 1 Corinthians, say, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself above the knowledge of Christ. So those imaginations that you have, you cast them down.
Amen.
Say, devil, get out of my mind. Get out of my marriage. Holy, my marriage is peaceful. My children are not vagabonds. Because sometimes the devil wants you to tell your sons you are useless. You are daughters. Tell them you will never become anything. No, you bless them. Even as they are hurting you, you are blessing them. At the time the devil will say this is not working, the devil will let the family. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We thank you, Lord, for being on that your us. We give you all glory and adoration.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Put your hands together for Jesus.